the cholinergic receptors. This is a high-yield topic. You really need to understand this when you're going into your boards or exams. These receptors are found in the central and peripheral nervous systems, and they use acetylcholine as their neurotransmitter. Thus, they can also be referred to as acetylcholine receptors, and their abbreviation is ACH for acetylcholine and R for receptor. There are two main types of these cholinergic receptors, the nicotinic acetylcholine receptors and the muscarinic acetylcholine receptors. The nicotinic acetylcholine receptors are named such because they are responsive to both acetylcholine and nicotine. They are ionotropic receptors, meaning that they are ligand-gated ion channels. When stimulated by their neurotransmitter, they themselves become an ion channel. The muscarinic acetylcholine receptors, on the other hand, are named such because they are responsive to acetylcholine and muscarin. They are a different kind of receptor. They are what's called a metabotropic receptor, meaning that they act through a second messenger system, which in this case refers to the fact that they are G-protein coupled receptors. Let's talk about the nicotinic cholinergic receptors first. And this is abbreviated the same as what we've seen, ACHR, except now with an N in front of it to denote nicotine. So the nicotinic cholinergic receptors, they're directly linked to ion-gated channels, as I previously said. There is no second messenger system here. The receptor is a physical part of the ion channel. These ion channels are made of 5 subunits, and they're arranged symmetrically around a central pore through which ions travel when opened. Also, each of these 5 subunits is made of 4 domains, which we might talk about later, however, it's not necessarily high yield right now. When stimulated by either acetylcholine or, remember, these are nicotinic cholinergic receptors, so either acetylcholine or nicotine can stimulate them, there is an initial stimulation, an initial opening, followed by a blockage or a refractory period. This is important and interesting to talk about because it's related to how some of the drugs work that we will talk about in other lectures. Let me give you a quick visual example of what is happening when these receptors are stimulated. I am going to place 2 molecules of acetylcholine on the screen and then 2 separate ions. And these ions can be sodium, potassium, calcium, and so forth. So what's going to happen is that the acetylcholine molecules are going to come down and interact with the receptor slash ion channel. This is going to cause a conformational change in the shape of the ion channel, which is going to open the central pore to allow ions through. Let's take a look. Kind of interesting, isn't it? Let me repeat this a couple more times. Kind of neat how that works, huh? Well, as if we didn't have enough abbreviations to remember, I have to add 2 more, unfortunately. There are 2 subtypes of the nicotinic acetylcholine receptors, the neuronal type, abbreviated NN, and the muscle type, abbreviated NM. The neuronal type is found in both the central and peripheral nervous system, and it is most often found upstream in the nervous system from other receptor types. So take, for example, the sympathetic nervous system and the associated adrenergic receptors. For a signal to get through to the adrenergic receptors, it must first travel through a neuronal type nicotinic receptor in an upstream ganglion or nerve. The muscle-type nicotinic receptors are found postsynaptically in the neuromuscular junctions, and they are responsible for our skeletal muscle contraction. They are what let us move and breathe consciously. So keep these 2 subtypes in mind. At the end of this lecture, I will give a picture and an example and walk you through where they are. But for now, let's skip on to the muscarinic receptors. Okay, so the muscarinic receptors are a little bit different than the nicotinic receptors. First of all, they're named muscarinic receptors because they are responsive to acetylcholine and muscarin. Also, they use a second messenger system to propagate the signal. In this case, it's the G protein coupled receptors. I am not going to go into great detail on the G protein coupled receptors. There will be a separate lecture for that. However, just as an overview, let me walk through what's happening. This picture on the right represents six basic steps of a G protein coupled receptor. Let's zoom in on step one. Okay, what we have here is the receptor within the membrane of the cell. The brown oval near the top represents the ligand. In this case, we're talking about acetylcholine or muscarin. The ligand binds to the receptor and induces a conformational change. This conformational change activates the alpha subunit, which then exchanges its GDP for GTP. This allows the alpha subunit to disassociate from the beta and gamma subunits and interact with other intracellular proteins, which continues the signal transduction. Then the next step to reset the receptor is that the ligand is released from the receptor and the alpha subunit reattaches to the receptor. So you can see that this receptor works completely different from the nicotinic cholinergic receptors. And again, just as a reminder, this was in no way a detailed explanation of the G protein coupled receptors. If you need more information, another video is coming. So just as there were two subtypes of the nicotinic cholinergic receptors, there are subtypes for the muscarinic ones as well. There's actually five subtypes of muscarinic cholinergic receptors. However, only three of those are high yield, so those are the only three that I'm going to cover. M1, M2, and M3 are the high yield muscarinic receptors. Starting with M1. M1 is a GQ protein coupled receptor. It increases exocrine gland secretions, such as increasing the saliva that we produce in our mouths, and also increasing the stomach acid that we produce. M1 receptors are also found in the central nervous system, where they're thought to play a role in the way that we form memory. M2 receptors are GI protein coupled. What I want you to think of when you think M2 is increased heart parasympathetic effects. And that would be a decrease in the chromotropy, inotropy, and dromotropy of the heart. M3 receptors? Well, they're GQ protein coupled. So the odd numbers here, 1, 3, and 5, are GQ protein coupled receptors, while M2 and M4 are GI protein coupled. What I want you to think of when you think of M3 is an increase in the classic parasympathetic effects, such as an increase in bronchoconstriction, an increase in endocrine and exocrine secretions. So that's the rest and digest of the parasympathetic system. Increase in eye accommodation and an increase in vasodilation. So next, how about we put all of these receptors, including the nicotinic receptors, on one picture and talk about where all of them are. Alright? Alright, let's do it. Let's put it together. These two pictures, I think, are really cool pictures. They've got a lot of good detail, and I think they're great to study from. I didn't create these images. If you want to go find them yourself or printing them and studying from them, I've got some links on the side for you. The picture on the left represents the parasympathetic nervous system, and the picture on the right is kind of an overlay of the same picture, but it represents the sympathetic nervous system or the sympathetic fibers. Now, remember, we're talking about receptors. We're not necessarily talking about nerve types, just receptors. So starting with the parasympathetic nervous system, the picture on the left, let's zoom in on a couple of these organs. The heart, the bronchial tree, and the stomach. So starting with the heart, which of the cholinergic receptors are found here? At this location, you're going to find the nicotinic receptors. Which subtype of nicotinic receptors? The neuronal nicotinic receptors. What about here? Remember, this is the parasympathetic nervous system that we're talking about right now. These are going to be muscarinic receptors, okay? But which subtype of muscarinic receptors? Well, that's a little bit of a tricky question. It's not cut and dry, but generally, if you'll remember the previous slide, we talked about the M2 receptors you can generally think of as increasing the parasympathetic tone on the heart. So an increase in parasympathetic tone equates to a decrease in chromatropy, inotropy, and dromotropy. Next, how about the bronchial tree? Which receptor is found here on this new green dot? Again, this is a nicotinic receptor. Nicotinic receptors are found before muscarinic receptors. Which subtype of nicotinic? Neuronal. Neuronal nicotinic receptors. What about here? Again, there will be a little bit of variation, but generally, but think back to the previous slide, M3. The M3, the muscarinic acetylcholine receptor subtype M3, are generally associated with the classic parasympathetic effects, one of those being bronchoconstriction. Next, which is this? There's a pattern here. I hope you're picking up on the pattern. This is a nicotinic receptor again. Which kind? A neuronal nicotinic receptor. Again, nicotinic receptors always come before other types of receptors. What about this one? Okay, so this is a little bit tricky. If you remember the previous slide, there were two different subtypes of muscarinic receptors that could increase the production of exocrine secretions. And that was M1 or M3 of the muscarinic type. Pretty cool, huh? Now let's move over and talk about the sympathetic nervous system. And I'm going to pick on the same organs, okay? So which receptors are found here? Nicotinic. Neuronal nicotinic. It's a pattern. Neuronal nicotinic receptors are found first in the chain. Other types of receptors are found later. What about here on the heart? Remember, this is the sympathetic nervous system. Little bit of a trick question. I need you to think outside of the box. These are going to be the adrenergic receptors, not covered in this lecture. Do you remember those? Alphas and beta receptors, usually stimulated by norepinephrine. Okay, next. Which receptor is this? Easy, right? Neuronal type nicotinic. And here? Well, again, this is the sympathetic nervous system, so it's going to be an adrenergic receptor that's going to decrease the production of stomach acid so that more energy can be used for the fight or flight response. Lastly, something that isn't shown very well, the skeletal muscle system. Which receptors are found here? Nicotinic receptors. But what kind of nicotinic receptors? Those are going to be the muscle type nicotinic receptors. That's pretty cool, huh? All right, good job, guys. Okay, guys, time for a little friendly knowledge challenge. No pain, no gain, right? So the way this is going to work is I am going to flash a drug name on the screen. And I want you to think about what that drug does as far as its mechanism of action, its therapeutic use, and also its side effects. If you don't know all the answers, that's okay. You can pause the video, you can think about it, or you can just learn from it. You don't have to know the answers. Okay, you ready? Let's go. First drug, bethanacol. Bethanacol is used for post-op neurogenic ileus and also urinary retention in the case of an atonic bladder. What is its mechanism of action? Well, bethanacol is a muscarinic agonist. Structurally, it's very similar to acetylcholine. However, there are some small changes to some side groups that allow it to be selective for muscarinic receptors and also blocks it from being hydrolyzed by acetylcholine esterase. Let's zoom in on our picture and see the location of the mechanism of action. All right, there it is, the little green circles. This is where it's working. It is stimulating things. It's making things move. It's making things contract. Can you see how that would work for both post-operative ileus and also an atonic bladder? Okay, so the side effects now. And I'm going to read this list off from a well-known drug reference. I'm not making this up, folks. Urinary urgency. Isn't that why we're taking the drug? diarrhea. Again, isn't that why we're taking the drug? How about abdominal cramping, increased gastric motility, bronchoconstriction, hypotension? Are you starting to see something interesting here? This is the cool thing about understanding drugs and their mechanism of action. If you really understand the mechanism of action, you don't have to memorize all the side effects. They intuitively make sense. We gave this person, or this imaginary patient, a muscarinic agonist. There are muscarinic receptors all over the body in a lot of different systems. We're stimulating all of them. There's also increased salivation, lacrimation, and meiosis. Isn't that cool? Just taking the extra work to really understand what a drug does and where it works can save you a lot of headache in memorizing side effects. Hey guys, this is Joel. Thanks for all the good comments on the other videos and the emails and your support. Hey look, if you've got something to say, if you've got a question, leave me a comment. I'll get back to you as soon as I can. Like me, subscribe to me, and as always, good luck in school.